请问Hawaii Chinhua Southern 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 The purpose of this discussion, I think, is to confuse the scene further. Actually, we decided on this topic a long time ago, before the recent controversy, and perhaps it just happened that it happened, and I think it's a good time to also explore further issues involved in local governance at all level, and not just at the local level. And perhaps, I think my portion of the talk is not to provide a definite answer. We are pointing to, perhaps to identify the problem, point to the situation, explain the situation, imagine what is not there yet. I think our role here today, perhaps, is not to provide a definite answer on what sort of electoral system, whether you have a chief minister directly elected, or you have a parliamentary system. I think those are leaving to the expert, like Wong Jin Huat. But our role is to actually say there is something that we can explore further, and perhaps eventually we settle on something in Bentuan. But that thinking process is important for all of us. Kuala Lumpur suffered double deprivation. Ratepayers of Kuala Lumpur not only not have the second vote, not only have the third vote. I mean, we are talking about the third vote now. So local election was banned on the 1st of March 1965. But Kuala Lumpur not only do not have the third vote, it also do not have the second vote. And Kuala Lumpur is deprived of its elected local government through Federal Capital Act 1960. Now this is rarely discussed. I've read so many discussions, it's not there. Next. But the third point is Kuala Lumpur is further deprived of its elected state government in 1974 through the formation of federal territory. This is well known. But the Federal Capital Act 1960 was not widely discussed. Next. Brief history. In 1950, there was a local authorities election ordinance, and in 1952, the first city election in Kuala Lumpur happened in 1952. Chin Huat has written extensively about that. The first election under the 1950 local authority ordinance was supposed to be held in Melaka, but there was no contest in Melaka, so the election was done without contest in Melaka. And the next election was also held in 1951, that was in Penang. And in 1952, the earth-shaking Kuala Lumpur election happened when UMNO and MCA came up and eventually became the model for UMNO and MCA to work together. The coalition happened when Kuala Lumpur MCA was actually defined the national leaders. The national leaders wanted MCA KL to work with Dato Oon's party, but the KL chief decided to work with UMNO. And that was history. In 1960, Kuala Lumpur is deprived of an elected city government through the Federal Capital Act. And in 1965, all local elections were suspended. 74, as we know, 76, Local Government Act effectively killed off the third branch and make local council a branch of the state government. I think when we discuss whether to revive the third ward, Rapsha is going to organize a conference on 7th of March on local elections and local governance. And we want to go further and go deeper. Today, if you have local elections immediately, I think all the state government practically can close shop. Reason being, today's local council act as if it is a branch of the state government. And the state government operates through the local council. And it has been there for the last 50 years. So when we talk about local elections, we have to revisit our three-tier democracy. We may have to strengthen the state government, both from devolving or decentralizing power from the national to the state, and perhaps we need to reorganize local council as well. Now those issues have not been discussed so far in the mainstream discussion. And when we talk about reviving local elections, I think it's not just about voting, but it's about how to make councils, how to make government work for the people. So those are the issues that we have to discuss in the months to come. Apart from the big debate that happened every day in the media, I think we need more discussions, deeper discussion. Next. Now I want to spend some time to talk about the Federal Capital Act. The whole idea of Federal Capital Act is that because Kuala Lumpur is federal capital, therefore you cannot have government. Now that's the argument. So federal capital of Kuala Lumpur has not had an election since 1960. Not 1974. 1974 it was deprived of the vote to vote for state government. But 1960 onwards there were no local elections in Kuala Lumpur, whereas local elections were deprived, it was suspended elsewhere in 65. And the reason given was that it is a federal capital. Now in other federal capital, in Washington DC, there is a local government. In Canberra, it is like Putrajaya, it is an invented city out of nowhere, and I lived there for 4 years. Canberra has its own state government. It has only 300,000 people. It has its own state government. Of course, the same applies to Delhi, New Delhi, the same applies to many other places, Brasilia. So, but then in Malaysia, the idea that federal capital cannot have local election doesn't happen today. It happens in the 1960. The 1960 Act actually repealed what I've just mentioned, Local Authorities Election Ordinance of 1950, and other relevant acts. Next. Now I think Kuala Lumpur deserves more. Kuala Lumpur deserves more, and it helps us once we settle the question of Kuala Lumpur, we can settle the question of local councils or local democracies elsewhere. First, federal territories in other countries actually elect their local government as governing body. Second, given the creation of Putrajaya, the functions, as Kawai pointed out, the functions of Kuala Lumpur as federal capital has lost its meaning. Third, and the most important part, which will be the focus of my talk, is that no taxation without representation. Immediate measure should be taken to ensure transparency and accountability of KL City Hall, the fourth largest sub-national government in the country, in terms of money, financial terms, in fiscal terms. But of course, there are more things that we should do. But at the least, we must now call on some major changes, even without creating a state government immediately. Maybe creating a state government or having local elections takes years until Barisan Nasional is out of office. But at the least, there are measures, immediate measures, that the current Barisan Nasional government can take. One of them is to abolish the Federal Territory Ministry, in line with austerity policies that we are supposed to take. Next. Now, fiscal strength, this shows you, I don't know whether you can see at the back. I'm not sure whether you can see. Can you see from the back? No. Okay, I mean we can put this slide on our website. Basically, this is the spending. This is the spending of Kuala Lumpur DBKL from 2006 to 2015. The expenditure is around 2 billion. That's all consistently from 2006. Federal territories, DBKL alone spends more than 2 billion a year. Now 2 billion compared to federal government is nothing, because federal government spends, like this year, federal government budget is supposed to be 273 billion. So 2 billion is nothing compared to the funds that the federal government has or is about to use. But if you look at the next one, if you look at the next one, budgetary outlay of sub-national governments in Malaysia for 2015, you will see that budget for Sarawak, because the election is coming, budget for Sarawak is 6.3 billion. Budget for Sabah has always been big. 5.1 billion. Budget for Terengganu is big this year because of royalty, but not necessarily consistently so. Usually Kuala Lumpur is the highest in the peninsula, but this year Terengganu has the highest, budgetary outlay, which is 3 billion. Kuala Lumpur is the highest outside Sarawak, Sabah, Terengganu, and it's at 2.4 billion. Selangor is also 2.4 billion. In 2014, Selangor was 1.6 billion. Johor and subsequently the rest has a much smaller budget. Now, all other states, the entire budget has to be presented to the state assembly. Whether it's complete or not, we can demand more. But in Kuala Lumpur, you do not see the budget. Now, budget is not a budget speech. I always insist that Malaysians should understand or should read the full budget document, the detailed budget document. Now, I just checked with Kok Wai on Friday, because I was an assistant to Theresa Kok many years ago. I remember that we were not able to get a full document of budget from DBKL, but it was 1 or 2 years where someone smuggled from the government and we were able to read it. But Kok Wai confirmed that consistently DBKL do not reveal its itemized budget. So you actually don't see the itemized budget. Whereas you can see the itemized budget of federal government, you can see the itemized budget of state government. So Kuala Lumpur, while it has the largest, while it usually has the largest state budget in peninsula, I mean this year is an exception because of Terengganu, but it doesn't present an itemized budget for the public to scrutinize at all. Now, of course, on top of DBKL, there's something called Federal Territory Ministry. That is to create a position for Tunku Anand because they don't know where to place him. Now, Federal Territory Budget is 1.13 billion ringgit. Now, this is a federal budget. This is federal itemized budget. The entire budget of Federal Territory Ministry is 1.13. Next. Now this is what you have in the ministry. The reason why I say we do not need a federal territory ministry is that you already have DBKL, and I'll show you how complicated DBKL structure is. But now you have to pay a minister and his office, which costs about 2 million. You have to pay a deputy minister. Is the deputy minister the guy who came with the gun? Let's go out. Oh, deputy. Sorry, my fault. Okay, you have a deputy minister office. You have a KFU. You have a secretary general for the ministry. There is also other parts of the administrative cost of the ministry. The administrative cost of Federal Territory Ministry was 125 million ringgit in 2014 and 83 million ringgit in 2015. My take is that you don't actually need a federal territory ministry, and for many, many years we do not have a federal territory ministry. It's only because Tunku Anand needs a job and he couldn't be placed anywhere. The job was created for him. I'm stating a fact. The job was created for Tunku Anand so that he can move around with the ministry, with the secretary general. But this entire cost of 83 million is a bit too wasteful just to create a job for Tunku Anand. You can see that actually from the ministry, not much direct contribution from the ministerial budget to DBKL, because DBKL is quite rich with its own resources. Federal Territorial Ministry basically manages these three units. Labuan, most of the Labuan expenditure comes from federal government. Putrajaya, even more. 100 million from Federal Territory Ministry. DBKL only received 60 million ringgit from the ministry, but the ministry spent most of its time trying to meddle into decision. Tunku Anand trying to meddle into decision in DBKL. Next. Okay, this is something that I think would require a lot more scrutiny. This is from the federal itemized budget. I'm showing you this part also to tell you that DBKL does not have an itemized budget, whereas this is the federal itemized budget. The last item, NKEN, National Key Economic Area, this year, 500 million is allocated to Federal Territory Ministry with just four letters, NKEA. You don't know what it is actually all about. This 500 million is of dubious usage, and more scrutiny has to be done on it. Next. Now, this is DBKL. I started as a DAP staffer to Theresa Kok back in 1999 when she was first elected, and that's where I learned about DBKL structure. We didn't know how DBKL actually works, so at that time she was first term MP, and I was also I was a first assistant. What we did was to learn from Kok's assistant and also to check the DBKL phone book in order to understand how it works within DBKL. And I found out that consistently for the last 15 years after I started learning about DBKL structure, every now and then the Dato' Bandar will clash with the Ketua Pengarap. I think Kok Wai later can talk about how many clashes between the Dato' Bandar and Ketua Pengarap. There is the Dato' Bandar in KL, in DBKL. There is the Ketua Pengarap. Power is supposed to be, administrative role is supposed to be held by Ketua Pengarap, whereas power is supposed to political power supposed to lie in the Dato' Bandar, but both of them are bureaucrats. And on top of that, there is now a minister who has a lot of time to meddle into how DBKL is run. And then you have a secretary general in the federal ministry. So if you imagine, on top of the Dato' Bandar, he has to fight with the Ketua Setia Usaha, and then Ketua Setia Usaha will fight with the minister. And at the bottom, you have Ketua Pengarap, and under Ketua Pengarap is all the administrative arm. Decisions are hard to come by, and a lot of personality clashes that happens in the ministry with no political discussions and no scrutiny. Political debates, clashes may not necessarily be bad. Okay? In a democracy, you see people fighting over how to do things. And I don't think that is necessarily bad for a democracy. If open debates are allowed and with proper scrutiny, I think that is okay. But when these people fight in the process, what do they fight? They fight over projects. They fight over which project to prioritize and which approval to give. I don't think that is good for the city to grow. The city has to grow organically. The city has to grow with proper political accountability to the people. And I think this is something that we have to change. And you know how unnecessary the structure is. And I think the first thing to call for is to call for the abolishment of FT ministry. Thanks. So the federal territory or DBKL doesn't have a council. Now we are not talking about local council. I see some of the local councillors from Selangor sitting in this room. In all other parts of this country, when it comes to local council, there is actually a council. All of them are appointed, whether in Pakatan State or in BN State. All councillors are appointed, but they are councillors sitting in the council, and municipal budget has to be presented to the council. Some council, what they call reveal their budget, some council have it closed off. But councillors has to approve the budget. Councillors are part of the decision-making process. Not an ideal situation, but then councillors are involved. In Kuala Lumpur, there are no councillors because of Federal Territory, Federal Capital Act 1960. There is an advisory board. There's an advisory board, usually 12 person. Two of them has to be from Selangor, and they are all appointed by Yang Di-Pertuan Agong at the advice of the Prime Minister. This is the constitution of the advisory board. Next. Now these are the current advisory board, members of the current advisory board. I'm not sure if I know any one of them. Apart from Tan Sri Isa, not very sure whether I know any of them. Next. Now, this is interesting. The commissioner means Dato' Bandar. In this, commissioner means Dato' Bandar. Commissioner may act in opposition to the advisory board. What is this telling you? Basically, Dato' Banda, even with an advisory board which has already had no power, Dato' Banda can still define the recommendation of the advisory board. So in other councils, it's a different situation. If the councillors vote your budget down, you cannot move unless the state government comes in to overrule. This is in the case of other councils. But in the case of Kuala Lumpur, the ministers, basically Dato' Banda is not responsible or not accountable to anyone, even to the advisory board, with the exception of the minister. Next. Power of the minister to issue directive, the minister can basically, from time to time, issue any directive to Dato' Banda, and Dato' Banda has to comply. Next. Now, Dato' Banda, the Dato' Banda, or commissioner here in this act, just have to prepare an account, and the account or the report is to be laid on the table of Dewan Negara and Dewan Rakyat. That's all, nothing else. No debate, no one scrutinizes it. Next. Now this is a self-praise of the mayor in his speech in 2013 for the 2014 budget. The mayor said that prestasi kewangan 2012 yang telah diaudit dan dibentang di parlimen menunjukkan prestasi yang memberangsangkan dan prestasi kewangan dijangka akan lebih baik bagi tahun kewangan 2013. Now I couldn't find the budget speech for 2015. So I've only used the budget speech of 2014. On the DBKL website, the 2015 budget speech is not uploaded. Bentang di parliament, yes, there is a report on the table of parliament, and that's about it. No debate, no question, no way to ask anything. So I think recommendation, short-term agenda, abolish the Federal Territorial Ministry, subject the mayor's budget to the scrutiny of federal parliament, so that DBKL is responsible for to the parliament directly. And long term, I think DBKL is just not another local council. My entire speech, I didn't want to touch on how the state government should structure and all this, but I think DBKL has to be more than a local council. When we fight for anything for Kuala Lumpur, we shouldn't be just talking about restoration of local elections in Kuala Lumpur, but we should be talking about something that is beyond local council, preferably a state government, or something in between a local council and a state government. And I think something like a state or something similar to sub-national government structure is required for Kuala Lumpur. How to structure it, I think we should have more debates about it. Next. I just want to show you two photos, two interesting characters. This is the Seoul mayor who is still in office. The Seoul mayor, I met the Seoul mayor twice. Once in 2010, as he was still an NGO person, Park Woon-sun. Park Woon-sun was an NGO person, he was a human rights lawyer until 2000, when he felt that Korea was already a democratized society, and he decided to quit human rights advocacy and move to a think tank, move to form a think tank to advocate a better city. So he spent about 10 years on the NGO front, and I attended his conference in 2010. It was interesting, they were trying to look for very basic solutions how to improve the city. In 2011, Park Woon-sun participated in by-election, the Seoul mayoral by-election. He won, and he was at that time NGO. Now many people in Malaysia say, oh, we don't need politicians at the local council. I disagree. I think you need politicians at the local council, but whether you need the same sort of politicians or local elections should allow or should actually be the breeding ground for new politicians, new type of politicians. That I think is possible. And we should actually see local elections or municipal elections or city elections as a breeding ground for new type of political cooperation, and meet even new type of political parties, and new type of politicians, for them to emerge and to capture the imagination of the nation. Park Woon-sun was re-elected in 2014, and he is now the number one is on the top on the poll to be opposition candidate for the next presidency. Yeah, he's now listed as the top politician from the opposition. He has since joined the opposition. He's now the leading voice in the opposition for the next presidency, next presidential election will happen in 2017. The other guy, of you probably, next one, you've probably seen this guy more. This is called Jokowi. I met him in 2012 when he was still the mayor of Solo. He was still in KL. We met him. And you can see the transformation of Jokowi from a mayor of Solo in January 2012. He is now president of Indonesia. In between, he was also governor of Jakarta. You see, local election has given so many opportunities for Indonesian politicians at all levels, from mayoral positions to governor. Governor, which is the reason why I talk about state government or state government-like positions or structure in Kuala Lumpur, is that when Jokowi was mayor of Solo, he was a mayor. But the Jakarta structure is like a provincial government. Jakarta structure is like a provincial government. He was the governor. And under Jakarta, there are multiple local councils. There are multiple local councils in Jakarta. Like in London, you have multiple councils, but there is a mayor on top of that, which is not the ordinary local council. Now, these are the things that I think we should all discuss. We should open up the debate, not just about whether to have election or not, whether Malay or non-Malay or not. I think we should go beyond race. We should talk about Malaysia that is to come, a Malaysia that we can all reimagine, we can structure it in such a way that will work for all Malaysian ordinary Malaysians. With that, I thank you very much.